Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
Today's episode of the Mike O'Mara Show is brought to you by our bonus packages. Please go to MikeO'MaraShow.com and click on the bonus banner. You'll get access to all of our bonus content, and even better, you'll be helping out TMOS. So please, quit sucking, and we thank you.
Available on demand every day in iTunes and the Google Play Store and around the world on MikeO'MaraShow.com. What more can we do for you? It's the Mike O'Mara Show.
Well, it's time for our second show taping today. We just did our first one that wasn't recorded.
I enjoyed it.
Right before we got started. But as I come to you from the great state of Florida, and we have the two boys are up there in D.C., and the boy down here is in Florida. I come to you from a steadily mungy household as the air conditioning decided to quit in my domicile. And as you know, being close to the equator down here, it's a little warmer down here.
Yes, a trifle bit.
So we've been without air conditioning since Saturday, probably around noon. Because losing air conditioning is almost identical to getting any kind of injury or illness. They never happen at 8 a.m. on a weekday.
No.
What happens at 5 o'clock on a Friday, that's when stuff turns to crap.
Yeah.
That's when it turns to crap, and that's what happens. So I am dealing without air conditioning as the continuing saga of the house that we purchased from these criminals sold us this house, where anything that is even considered, I would not consider an air conditioning unit to be an appliance, but I'm putting it under the umbrella of the defective stove, the defective microwave, the defective refrigerator.
Ice maker.
It is now the defective air conditioning unit.
And
I'm probably going to piss off a lot of people around the country when I tell you, I won't mention the name of the product, Lennox. Or I should say, Lennox.
I thought they made dishes.
Oh, you chitty chitty bang bang, chitty chitty bang bang. We love you. Oh, you chitty. It is so.
What's the age of the? Do you know the age of the unit?
That's it's there. It's right at the borderline. But you got to remember,
5 years, 10 years. How long do these things last?
No. It's they go 15. They can go about 12 to 15 years. And I'm in that early part of that run. We have been keeping it together with baling wire, and I will tell you, we have had the guy out here so many times. We now know the
Johnny
name
Lennox?
Of the guy, Gary.
Gary Lennox.
Who is the repair guy.
Gary?
And we have opted today, because Gary won't be available till tomorrow morning, we have opted to go with one of the idiots as opposed to Gary, simply because of the urgency and the fact that I read online that when your air conditioning unit trips the breaker, and you're not able to turn it back on,
right,
that it usually is an easy repair.
Mm.
Easy in quotation marks. But I'm not quite sure. So, we'll find out.
So three, when you reset the breaker.
3 to 8 or something like that. 3 to 5 this afternoon.
So when you the breaker tripped for the air conditioning. It's got its own breaker.
Yes.
And when you
it's got a
to,
double little breaker.
Right. And when you reset it, it pops back?
Pop back in. And then I,
what
and
if
I
you
did
taped
it, like,
it?
I did it a bunch. You don't tape. No.
No?
That's a fire. That's a fire.
I don't know.
Waiting to happen.
That
I don't
is
know.
Funny.
Do you tie a string to it?
Do you? What's the swamp ass factor? Like,
yeah.
Are you there?
The
like,
SAF.
Not because we've had in the evenings. None.
Oh, that's
it's a non.
Nice. That's
it's a
nice.
Non. Now, though, as and by the way, I have closed the windows in the studio for the benefit of audio, as
Thank
opposed
you.
To
Thank
keeping
you.
Them open, and it's beginning to mung. Very, very quickly here. The unit itself, after I tried it about 4 or 5 times, I read online,
yes.
Went online, and it said, be sure not to click and reset it a bunch of times.
Yes, be sure not to do that.
Don't do that. Yeah, that's great that they tell you that after the fact. But we'll see.
Mike, a high of 79 today in Fort Myers.
Not bad.
That's
sunny. That's beautiful.
Yeah.
Love
that's
it.
Beautiful.
Love
currently
it.
But,
77.
And a cold snap coming through. But we're actually thinking that we need the unit to heat as well, because it's what, a heat pump? Is that what it is? It's a heat. It's the outside unit with the inside unit.
Yeah,
I thought an HVAC just gave you AC.
No, right? It's heating and air conditioning.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just in newer homes, my home just has air conditioning because I get the heat from the actual gas, the oil heat that goes through the
You have oil
pipes.
Heat.
Yes,
and you have radiators.
Yes.
Yeah. That is an old house. Yeah, but a lot of old houses.
And also, don't you get a lot of heat from the two houses on the side of you?
They keep me warm.
He pipes it
they
in.
Keep our house. They turned on their Christmas lights and it got
Maddie,
toasty.
Do I have enough light on my face? Because what I'm looking at right now is powder.
No, you look great, Mike. Lots of
Thank
dimension.
You, Thank you. Thank
oh,
you
lots of dimension. Who doesn't want dimension? Dimension?
Yeah, it's our video.
Dimension.
Depth. It's our video.
I love it. Welcome back, Maddie.
Hey, Maddie, welcome back from Buffalo.
Thank you.
I played golf over the weekend. Hey, there's a shock. With a guy that with a guy that knew your father.
Oh, yeah?
From Buffalo, yeah. Nice. I guess your father's well known. Well, he was mayor.
Was he a fan?
Yeah.
Or was he?
Yeah.
Most
people
used to say. Okay.
And did you see the new, I believe it is a new Ted Danson show about him becoming a mayor? And he has a daughter who figures prominently in the show. And I think
is that network television?
It is network television.
Don't watch it
anymore. It's Ted Danson. Of course it's network television.
Don't watch it.
You didn't like Booker?
No, I'm gone on that. I don't watch that at all. So we are going to muddle through today. That's what's going to happen. And
you look great. You don't look sweaty.
No, not yet. Not yet.
Okay.
You don't look like Albert Brooks in network in broadcast news.
Where did they show that? Where did they show? Oh, Rudy Giuliani. They
oh
put
my
that together
God.
On Morning Joe.
Jesus.
Hey, I watch Crikey. Morning Joe too. Shocker. I think I'm going to try to say shocker as many times as
Good.
I possibly can. They did a montage of broadcast news and Rudy Giuliani, which is the funniest damn thing I've ever seen.
Poor Rudy.
A video producer. What do they have to do? You know, where he just does the whole montage
right.
with Rudy, with the hair dye coming down his cheeks. Yeah, fun. Good time.
Someone would, you know someone's hated when you're on national television and none of your handlers come in like dab you up to take that off.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah, that goes back. We know that for a fact when Larry King would fart or fall asleep on his Mutual radio show, and nobody would try to wake him up because they would. It was funnier for them.
Is anyone signaling me back?
Say, or I should say him.
Him.
Yes.
A confidence I've never betrayed, I don't think.
No.
Maybe I've gotten drunk and done it. But
never on
Rob,
air.
You know who I'm talking
oh,
about,
yes.
right?
Oh, no, you've not, you haven't done it on
the tapes?
No,
yes.
No.
I haven't done it on air?
No.
And we would play the Larry tapes where it's like Larry would be entertaining calls at 2 a.m., and he would wake up in the middle of the question. And he said, "You want to rephrase that?"
That was his
because
big catchphrase.
That was his tell when he would fall asleep. Who could blame him?
But it's not like Mike. It's not like he was so hated at Mutual Broadcasting that they wouldn't help him, and then they would trade the tapes. It's not like that.
No, it's not like that happened on a regular basis where no. we get that. And every morning show disc jockey in America listened to Larry King because Larry King was on in the middle of the night back in the day. This is 30 years ago.
Yeah, you would listen to him on the way in from Annapolis, right?
I would listen from Annapolis to the whole thing, and it was fantastic. And it was really just special because I would never hear these things live.
Right.
I would always hear them at other points during the show. But listen, it's a shift I never enjoyed. I never did the middle of the night graveyard shift ever in my life. As a matter of fact, I never did middays until we gave up our afternoon show to
right.
do middays. I had done morning drive or afternoon drive. I had never done a nighttime shift, and I had never done a middle of the night shift. And I think a middle of the night shift would be just the absolute worst. I don't know.
Oh,
how
no,
you,
it was I, so I, much fun. I did it for two
really?
Years, just weekends.
You did it for 2 years?
Yeah.
Oh,
wow.
My God.
Just
how,
on the weekends.
How would it have, did you have visitors?
No.
By any chance?
No, I was afraid. I was afraid of losing the midnight shift. That's how terrible it was. Midnight to what?
Noon to 5 a.m.
6 a.m.
Midnight to 6 a.m. You did a 6. Tell me you didn't do a midnight to 6 a.m.
That was the shift at WHFS.
Wow, oh, Saturday
God.
Going into Sunday?
It was Friday going into Saturday and Saturday going into Sunday because nobody wanted to do it, and I wanted
oh,
to be on the air.
Oh, well, you know, that's paying your dues. That is
and
paying your dues.
The wackadoos that come out on a weekend night.
From music
right.
radio especially.
From music radio. Mm-hmm. It is fun.
Mm. Would you have a lot of phone conversations with interesting
no,
people?
No.
You didn't?
Because most of them were drunkards. And
inebriants.
They really didn't make too much sense. And then half the people wanted to fight you for not playing Creed. And then, or you said it was two songs away. What happened?
Oh, wow.
And a lot of calls from Deal, Maryland, which, you know.
Were you required?
Very unusual the phones are open at that particular
Were you required to troll the phones, or could you have just let them ring?
No, but I could have let them ring, but I needed to work on actually, you know, an air check for
Wait a minute,
air
for you,
meetings.
For you, that's no problem. That's like when you're the most awake.
It was great.
From midnight to 6 a.m.
I loved it. It's like you were going to surgery when you were living at home. You're like, Mom, I got to do that crazy shift. But I loved it.
Children of the night.
It was fun.
What was fun about it? Just out of curiosity. I mean,
I'd been on a major market station, and that's the only thing they were offering.
You know, I can kind of like
excited.
I can relate. I would do weekends at WJFK, which was essentially come in and press play on a reel-to-reel tape and wait for 20 minutes to do commercials. The notion that you're in the business, it's exciting at first. I can see it.
What, 21?
Yeah.
Right?
My weekend shift back at WOHN in Herndon, Virginia, I had to...
No longer in business, shift, Mike. No longer in business.
No longer. And I don't think the building's even up.
No.
I think they plowed it over, turned it into a parking lot. The sleep I lost, based on the listeners that I would have, when the Saturday night before I was going in to play what we called God Squad.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Which was a show called Powerline. And I know, and it was almost a primer on how to train a disc jockey, because you had to sign you had to take meter readings,
make up
and
the
you had
numbers.
To do all this stuff that they don't make you do anymore, and like meter readings to make sure the transmitter is like giving it the right voltage or something like that. And then you had to take albums, which was a power line. Mm-hmm. Then there was a reel of tape, which was some other public service. The radio stations were required to have a certain amount of programming for public service.
Yes.
And they stacked it in the morning on Sunday morning. And so I would have to take the reel-to-reel, put that on a machine, put the turntables on, and then blend all these together so that I could get the last hour, which I believe was 9 to 10. I got the last hour, and I was going to be on the air. And I could not sleep the night before. I was that nervous.
Wow. That's
exciting.
It was
only after being there a while that I realized there were maybe, if I was to do a calculation on people listening to me, there would have been nobody. nobody would have been listening. It would have been that.
You could have gotten more listeners by opening the window and yelling your shift out the window.
I had a guy that listened from a moose lodge. When they made the flip to country music, then we had a guy that was like, "Hey, is this Mike? It's so-and-so. Yeah. How are you? And I'm down here at the Moose. This is Kevin from the Moose Lodge." And I latched onto him because he was listening to me, and he would know what I was talking about. But it was God Squad was your power line. I wish I could remember all of them because there was a show from the Chamber of Commerce that they ran every single week, and a lot of people ran Casey's Coast to Coast on pop stations,
right?
If you were lucky enough to do that, but then you get that cherished hour of you, and you know, play things like Kenny Nolan and Rupert Holmes.
Oh, so it wasn't always country. So you had like middle of the road stuff when it started.
It was middle of the road. It was adult contemporary, as they called it, adult contemporary, which was one of the most dull formats.
I like
the world.
Dreaming.
But then, because dreaming can make you mine.
The night shifts quickly turned into holiday shifts. I remember eating Thanksgiving, I would say at 10 a.m. one time because I had to go in for the afternoon drive shift, which was a big deal because no one else wanted to do it on Thanksgiving. And my parents were kind enough to deal with me and say, "We're having Thanksgiving early because Oscarito has to go to..."
What time did you have your dinner? So you had to go for the midnight shift again?
No, I would go in. So once you paid your dues for how many years? A couple years before we actually broke out. And this was just me alone. I might have been 20 years old, 2021. And I remember I remember Bob Waugh walking up to me and saying, "Nobody wants to work Thanksgiving. Do you want to do the afternoon shift on Thanksgiving?" And I said, "Yes, I'll do afternoons." But my parents, who eat at 3, that's prime time, like Thanksgiving, you know, lunch, dinner, linner.
Sure,
linner. So they time shifted it. My dad was not happy. I'm telling you that much. He did not understand why he was doing this for his son, the DJ.
Well, you know,
so
it's
what
very
time
nice.
Did you eat?
We ate at 10 a.m.
10 a.m.
It's nice that our family did time shift because I had, I think, 5 consecutive Thanksgivings I didn't get to have with my family.
Yeah. Because your family didn't care enough to...
No. There was some left when I got home.
What time? So they were etched in. By the way, you were talking right before the show that you eat Thanksgiving dinner at 6 p.m.?
Yeah, we did it at 6. But we had good appetizers.
What's your traditional Thanksgiving dinner time?
I think like when we would do the big family thing, it was we tried to eat between the football games, so 4:30.
Okay.
That's respectable.
That would be after the second football game.
Well, yeah. I'm just yeah. just I said tried. You know, 4:30 is a pretty good estimate.
It's hard to do that.
If you eat before noon, I think you're communist.
Yeah, you can't do that.
We did 2:30, 3 o'clock.
That's good. I think that's normal.
That's good because that gives you time for a second play later on in the day.
I had a friend in college who one year came down to Thanksgiving, and he was like, "Hey, man, I don't mean to be rude, but it's noon, like, and I don't see like anything out." And I said, "Oh, well, we don't eat till like 3:34 if we're lucky." And he's like, "Oh my God, my family eats at noon every year." I'm like, "Hey, I can go tell my mom. She'll cook something up. She might have a carne asada for you, who knows, but it's not turkey."
That's why when Robb said 6 o'clock, so it was just this year, like when the whole family, so this year what, because it was just the immediate family decided to do it. I would imagine you in particular would be crazy by 6 o'clock.
We're a late eating family anyway. We don't usually
have
dinner.
Are you really?
Yeah, we don't usually have dinner until like 7:30.
Really?
So, yeah. So
wow. Latin style, I like that.
But yeah, so I was in no hurry to get the bird in the oven, so I didn't get it in until, I put it in at exactly 12 noon. And then we sort of worked backwards from there.
Man, see, I would never. We eat like toddlers here.
Yeah,
we eat
at 4:30. Yeah,
we eat like regular dinner at 4:30. And now with the fasting, I do the same thing.
The Thanksgiving window is that window, Mike. That's not.
I think that's the perfect. That's
window. The window, Maddie. What do you? What time do you guys eat at?
We usually do like 5 as well, but we're late eaters too, kind of like Robb. So
I think I'm in the minority when it comes to my early eating habits. I think I really am in the minority because, I mean, I know up in Maine, being around the family. It was always, you're eating dinner now. You're eating dinner. And Carla and my attitude would be like 4 or 5 o'clock. It's like, you haven't eaten yet?
Yeah.
Probably better for your digestive tract.
Yeah, you're not supposed to eat
late. Well, it's better for fasting, which is what we do. That's good too. But I mean, did you have anything super late after you had your 7? No, you're done. You're full, right?
There's pie later on.
There's pie later on. But what time?
When does dinner end?
9?
Dinner never ends, Oscar. In my home, dinner never ends.
I have to say that the bringing my daughter down here, and it is her second turkey in 3 or 4 years that she has cooked for us, and she is.
Oh, for a second, I thought you were talking about the boyfriend.
No, she is. The boyfriend was fine. Connor was very nice. We had a really good time with him too. He's a cool guy, great house guest, nice guy. Treats my daughter well. Checked all the boxes. Thinks about his future. Like that, took him out on the golf course. He doesn't get to play a lot, so he had his struggles out there, but then he got it. He was into it and totally motivated, so that was fun for me. But the turkey. And I will release this information. It's a recipe, I think. It's nothing that she created herself, but she did what's called a dry brine 12 hours before she cooked the turkey. And I am telling you, this is the second time she's made it. And this is, I always remember turkey leftovers, which we ate for days afterwards because we had a small group. I remember turkey leftovers being relatively flavorless, that there's a difference between, that is not the case with her turkey. This turkey was so fabulous, and because it's protein, 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 I was all about the turkey and not all the side dishes, which made me, I the only time I had the side dishes was on the actual day. And I will tell you about that later. Yes, Oscar.
I know that you're going to murder me for this, but is a brine like a clear coat on a car? Like, how do you brine something?
You know what? I was so disengaged from the process that I don't know what she did, but the way she explains it, I think she coats the outside with sugar and salt.
Ooh.
I think that's what she does. And I know that there was a glaze recipe where she glazed it. This thing came out looking like it ought to be on the cover of, I'll use Good Housekeeping,
nice.
Since that magazine is what people use. But then, so spectacular. But the way I judge it, leftovers. We literally had so few people, we carved one of the sides of the turkey and left the other one. And we had one breast that was used for leftover, and it was so moist. You know what? Here's the key to me. This is what I like. I like a turkey. Man, I'm getting hungry just talking about it right now.
Sounds amazing.
When you carve this turkey,
all
right, the meat of the breast meat, which was perfectly cooked, folded over and fell down. It was so moist. There was no dryness whatsoever. It just peeled off and fell down. It was spectacular. My daughter, and I put this, I posted this online. My daughter Elizabeth made the day. And it really does. If you have a fabulous turkey, it makes the day. It made the day for us.
Two really questions regarding the turkey, fresh or frozen?
Yes. Frozen.
Frozen. Okay. So you allowed time for it to thaw. And also,
right.
Organic or like a butterball?
Butterball.
Okay. Wow. Really?
Yeah. Butterball.
Now, traditionally, Oscar, a brine
that
is.
Has more antibiotic. We want to, I said, can we get the extra antibiotic turkey?
Yeah.
Can we get the turkey well, that has the chemicals?
Well, you won't get strep now,
it?
Mike. Now you
That's
won't get strep.
We figured this day, in this day and age, you know, you want to make it taste
good. Fight it with everything you got.
But right. Traditionally, a brine is a multi-day soak in like a salt water. That's
not
what you,
necessary.
But
not necessary.
But I'm curious. I want to read up on this dry brine because all the experts agree that brining a turkey, if you go to the effort, it makes a difference. But if the dry brine is this easy, maybe
Eddie
that's
poultry,
the solution.
Rob. At a poultry, you do the bride. You're gonna have a fabulous.
Better
they do
burn.
A chicken down here, little restaurant down here in
is it like
South Florida called the Pewter Mug?
The what?
The Pewter Mug.
Oh, I thought you said bug.
They were known for their roast beef, but we get the chicken and
sure.
It's brined and it's fantastic. You just you inject it. You hear a lot about injecting things into meat,
especially in Florida.
Meat. Yeah, meth. This is special meth turkey. It was spectacular. I know I'm going on and on and on, but I will tell you, I'll get you the recipe. I'll post it online sometime before
Stuffed
Thanksgiving.
Stuffed or a hollow cavity, Mike?
Hollow cavity.
A hollow cavity. Did you put any aromatics in there?
I don't know if she did, but she may have.
Yes.
I'm not even sure. I don't think she needed to after the turkey was cooked as well as it was cooked. And then we had the, the carb busters side dishes.
Yes.
Which is, it was delicious. It was, we had Carla's corn souffle, and then her mother had to make cream corn, too, because her mother likes cream corn.
Mm. Sure. Mm.
So that was it. And
corn
and then,
is welcome at any table, Mike.
Yeah, well, corn. Enjoy it a second time.
The Native Americans called it maize.
Yes, maize. It was delicious. It was spectacular. And the potatoes were fantastic. It was just really great. But I have to point out that even in my largeness, I have been making an effort to minimize, do portion control, carbohydrates,
sure.
and fasting. And by the time I went to bed on Thanksgiving, I was reasonably sure I was going to throw up. I felt horrible. I felt absolutely ill because I had a second helping of Thanksgiving dinner, and it was just it was too much. My body was just reacting.
And
to
you're
it.
Not
it was
in
not
you're
totally
not
cool.
you're not in training shape for eating like that anymore.
No, I'm not like Ikigumi or whoever that guy is. That,
Joe Chestnut, Joseph Chestnut.
No. There's the Japanese kid that I want to say Fujiyama or whatever his. His name is. Find out the kid that eats the professional eater.
You guy
that eats
or the guy
the
that retired?
Air.
Kobayashi.
No, this is Kobayashi.
That's it. Attaboy, Oscar.
Kobayashi. I love that name. Kobayashi eats the hot dogs.
The man retired from the world of professional eating because they wouldn't let him work outside the circuit.
Right.
It Crazy. Was.
Independent thinker.
Yeah. He said, "F here, you. I'm not eating anything else."
Died of starvation.
I enjoyed a 24-hour window. Of throwing caution to the wind. That's what I was going to allow myself. So it started in the evening on Thanksgiving Eve and wrapped up right before we turned in, which was early on the Thursday night. So that's what I did. And then this was my problem. I did have second helpings of turkey or a regular plate. And then in the evening, right about the time that 4 or 5 o'clock, I decided that I would go into the kitchen and I did not eat anything other than a massive helping of stuffing on the side of it, a massive helping of mashed potatoes.
Mm.
And then I covered that whole thing with gravy and I sat in a chair like the glom that I am and I shoved it into my mouth. And it was immediately after that, maybe about 20 minutes after that, I thought, I'm gonna be ill. I am going to be ill.
But
it was
you
the
powered
Carb
through.
Buster special.
You powered through.
Yeah, woke up in the morning and I was fine after about 4 hours in the bathroom. I was fine and it was disgusting.
Did
it's
you
a
use
disgusting way to eat?
Did Mike did earn the phrase "something your brains out"?
It was just a long process. It was a long process. It really was like I might as well have eaten glue. as far as I was
concerned. What was that line in, God, was it is it Hubie Halloween?
I didn't make it to the end.
There's a great line that when he busts through the door of like one of the people's, like that he's trying to protect, one of the families.
Right.
And he says, how many bathrooms do you have? And the lady's like, 3 or 4. And she's like, good, I'm going to need all of them.
Well, it was not pleasant.
Or was it more like Uncle Buck? He says, well, you have good plumbing here, right?
Right. By the way, if you consider doing the disorder thing where you put your finger down your throat.
Yes.
That's when you, and I gave it a few, I'm terrible at throwing up, so I don't throw up very often.
I'm great
at
it.
That's why my body is fit. You're great at throwing up?
Yeah, as a matter of fact, I'm half bulimic. I've got the binging down.
I wasn't going to say the word, but he doesn't know.
He doesn't know
because he's stupid.
People are
that
suffering.
Way. That's the way he does that. Yeah,
joke was written to me by Pony.
They
and
run
texted.
The Crown. Robb runs a disclaimer in a huge disclaimer prior to showing Princess Diana, the character of Princess Diana, played by the actress with an eating disorder. They actually run a very extensive disclaimer.
My apologies.
No longer, you got to remember the era that we're in right
now.
That's
right. 2020.
That's what it is. Exactly. But I have to tell you, it was a primer as to what food that's bad for you or food that's bad for me. I think there are plenty of people out there that could probably eat that food and do fine. Carbs attack my
and
body.
Do you think
they not
maybe
only pile fat on it, but they make me feel like garbage.
It also
made me feel like Oscar when we gave him the donuts.
I remember that.
Down.
Yeah,
he went into
the coma.
Yeah, he had to go horizontal. But also, it had to do with portions. Do you think if you had had a smaller portion of potatoes and gravy and stuffing, you might have been able to do better?
Of course, portion control. Mm. But also, there was a sugar element wild card that we had, as well as the mini desserts, mini pumpkin pies. Mini cheesecakes.
Yes.
We had mini, Elizabeth made mini pineapple upside down cakes.
That's your winner right there.
Oh, my God. Fantastic.
A tropical treat.
However, somewhere along the line, may have been drinking when it happened. The idea to purchase, and Carla did it, on Thanksgiving, the day before Thanksgiving, 2 dozen Krispy Kreme donuts, which we also enjoyed. And that may have been the killer.
Wow.
That may have been the killer.
How many did you eat?
Total? Between the night before? Yeah. Probably 6.
Oh, that's fair.
Between Wednesday and
three
Thursday.
3 a night, not a big deal?
Yeah. And then one during the day. And then there was just one. Maybe after the stuffing.
Yes.
There may have been that last one that I ate like this.
Too tired to chew.
Just something savory.
Yeah. Well, it'd be sweet.
But overall, I don't know donuts.
You know, I could do, Elizabeth could just cook the turkey and that would be fine. And I think a lot of this conversation happens in a lot of households where you say, you know, maybe next year, not all the heavy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe
of course.
Just the turkey and a green vegetable. And it's like, yeah, that would be a good idea. And you know you're lying. You know you're lying when you said it. And you know the people that are agreeing with you are lying as well. You know, and I would say that and then pop a Krispy Kreme into my mouth right after that. Fantastic.
The most useless use of electricity in my house this year was cooking the green beans in a crock pot. I might as well have just, you know, why bother? Why even bother? Because it's, you know, the green vegetables, they're not a factor.
Yeah,
the
green
day.
Bean's garbage, in my opinion. Yeah. I'm sorry. The green bean. I think the green bean is one of the reasons kids don't like vegetables.
Yeah.
All right? It's really one of the reasons green beans don't make it onto the menu. Why do you think people boil them in a crock pot? You tried to do that, right? Did you try to cook them beyond recognition?
No, you know what?
With like some fat in there? Is that what you put in
there?
Yeah, the
way, it's fine. It's fine if you do it, but it's fine like any other meal of the day vegetable. But
explain the spiwak green beans.
The spiwak green beans
actually goes
back to my grandmother, and it's you water, salt, pepper, some pork fat, beans, teaspoon of sugar, and you cook them till they're mush. That's it.
That's what he puts in his vegetable.
Mm-hmm. Pork fat?
Yeah, for flavor.
Mm. Right. Mm-hmm. Our green bean recipe is very similar. This is the Fat Man green bean casserole. This is the Fat Man green bean recipe. Green bean casserole is a totally different
thing. Onions,
In our house, it's a base, slow cook, just like Robb. Base of green beans, a little white wine, 3 Krispy Kreme donuts, 1/2 cup of maple syrup, an entire salt lick, 1 bay leaf, a 6-pack of Miller Lite,
and eggs sprinkled on top.
Delicious.
You can eat.
And don't forget the bay leaf, Oscar. Don't forget the bay leaf. That's for flavor.
Right. Hard boiled and recooked.
Oh, really? Twice cooked eggs?
Yeah, and then it's off to the vomitorium.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. You can listen to the Mike O'Mara Show at www.mikeomarashow.com.
Stay tuned for an outstanding entertainment program.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show.
Let's get down to business.
From the entertainment capital of the world.
It's the Mike O'Mara Show. Mike O'Mara, Robb Spiewak, Oscar Santana. And now, from his office chair, here's Mike.
Post holiday greetings. Hope your holiday was spectacular. We're now officially in the Christmas season.
You know, Mike,
Monday.
I pulled that tape before I knew you had a clinker in your house.
Yeah, clinker!
It's a clinker!
It's hot in here right now. So hot, so mungy. We are live from the Podcast Village Studios in our nation's capital and also down here in the belly of the furnace. Glad to be with you,
God's
TMOS
furnace.
Fan.
Yeah, God's furnace.
San Bernardino, California. Waves, North Carolina. Demorest, Georgia. Well, thank you. Welcome to Demorest, Georgia.
Georgia.
Grafton, Virginia, Louisville, Kentucky, and Helsinki in Finland,
Finland.
The Mike O'Mara Show is on now and brought to you by this fine product that I'm holding up for you right now. It's called Truff. Want to know why it's called Truff?
Why?
You see what it says? It is white infused.
White truffle infused.
What? It's not white infused. It's white truffle infused.
White truffle infused hot sauce.
This is yummy. It doesn't matter if it's breakfast, lunch, or dinner, or anything in between. The right hot sauce is going to make your food to go up a notch to the next level.
Yep.
Truff. That's T-R-U-F-F. F-S. F-F is in flippin' fantastic. Am I right, ladies?
Mm-hmm.
It's a luxury hot sauce that makes every meal five stars. Crafted with a signature blend of red chili, black truffle, organic agave nectar, and savory spices. We have the first person who tried Truff. He's Robb Spiewak. You loved it, loved it, loved it.
I loved it. I have to fight Robert for it. He lives on it. But here's the thing. It took my creamed onions on Thanksgiving to the next level. I sometimes use cayenne pepper, but I opened this stuff and tasted it. I said, this is exactly right. So not only did it make the creamed onions great, Robert found a way to put it on his turkey and his stuffing. This stuff
really good.
Is amazing.
Look at how beautiful the packaging is.
And the packaging is
gorgeous.
Look at
that bottle.
Fantastic.
Look at that sealed bottle. Each bottle pristinely packaged, ready to gift, topped with Truff's eye-catching black diamond-shaped lid. You see that?
Yeah.
Am I getting
wonderful?
Am I getting that?
It's dimension.
See, that's
Mike.
A black diamond shaped lid, hinting the truffle infused treasure inside. It's more than a hot sauce. It's a showstopper. It's a showstopper.
Big Truff hot sauce.
Big see Truff. Bubbies. It's like nothing you ever tried before. Robb mentioned he uses it every meal. See for yourself why Truff is the biggest hot sauce on Instagram and TikTok. And right now, get 10% off site-wide when you use promo code TMOS at a very simple website, truff.com, T-R-U-F-F.com. That's 10% off everything, anything. That's 10% everything. Manny Masiello, Pony Boy Matt Bloom, Robb had a holiday weekend.
What a great
Slacker.
Day.
Bumpuses!
Finally.
10% off everything.
Thank you.
Anything, including white truffle VIP box, including the white truffle VIP. The white truff VIP box.
Beautiful packaging on that.
And now that's not a twofer, right? It's one piece of copy if he messes up.
Right, one a day. One a day.
Yeah.
And the Truff Variety Pack just in time for the holidays. Just shop at truff.com. That's T-R-U-F-F. Remember, F as in flavor.com and use promo code TMOS. Yum, yum, yum.
Good stuff.
I don't have anything to put it on, but I'd like to put it on my tongue right now. Maybe I will.
You should.
A little dabble, do you?
It's got a good front and back burn. Foodies will understand what I mean when I say that. It has got the
really,
perfect
really
heat.
Good.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. There it is. There's my truff.
Mm-hmm. All right. There you go. Real time.
Oh, my. Oh.
Taste.
Good stuff, huh?
I love hot sauce.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's the best.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That's good.
That's
yes.
Good.
The best.
Good.
Oh, wow. You put it on eggs?
Oh, God, yes. Scrambled eggs, yeah. The best.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep, fantastic. Mm-hmm. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. We're doing our post-Thanksgiving little post-mortem. I hate it when people call it a post-mortem. Post-mortem on a show, post-mortem. Nobody died. I hope
No.
Well, a lot of people died in the country.
No.
Jesus
there's
Christ.
That.
Yeah. People are still dying. Yeah, there's that little fact. God, as we're still idiots, but I'm not talking about it.
No.
We're talking about the... Hopefully everybody stayed safe in our listening audience.
Not going to see a spike in 10 days, Mike. Not going to see it.
Mm-hmm. You know, the thing about it is I don't want to talk. People, I get the rap for being Johnny Curmudgeon, but I have to tell the truth that I decided because neighbors around here are decorating and I went to the storage unit because we have a small place. We don't have storage. And we got the tree and the Christmas
decorations. Isn't that where the boyfriend was sleeping while he was
down?
It's
where we put him for most of the weekend.
Right, in the storage unit.
Well, he's not sleeping in the same bedroom as my daughter.
Certainly not.
Hell no.
Yeah, so, yeah, they've got air conditioning in there.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah,
well, he probably made out better than you then.
I'm sure he did. But anyway, I truly don't want to say this, but I have to say that over the weekend, at one point, I went to look for some extension cords, just that little last-minute stuff. To just decorate. And of course, they've got the big Lowe's display at the big box store. And I had not for any other reason. Carla told me when I told her this story that I need help. She may very well be right. I had the Christmas spirit just sucked out of me. Just sucked out of me with the shoulder to shoulder. It just, I have to sometimes fight it. I have to fight it. And Carla said what I should do is envision everybody is my mom or a relative and realize that they're doing this because they – and not think of them as non-humans that are just in my way. But I have trouble doing that. I just get out there and the people that are all in one giant box store coagulated in the place that I want to be, I think it's a combination of feeling embarrassed – that I'm just like the herd, that I just go in there to get the same stuff, that I just, I wish I had my act together, but I don't. And by the way, the industry of Christmas crap, the industry of Christmas garbage is predicated on the fact that stuff breaks and it's so cheaply manufactured that you're going to need it again next year.
Lights.
They count on it. I'm sure they have algorithms
lights.
That do it.
One goes out,
it's
half
garbage.
A string, garbage.
It's garbage. It's plastic. It's got that fake glitter on it. It's garbage. And, you know, and so you want to just be festive. And I've got a 7-year-old, so I want the place to look good. But I'm stupid about it. And I always forget. And a box will have this adapter or this extension cord. And by the way, whoever sells the long cord with the multiple plugs on it, you know, what the F good does that do when the first part of it is 3 inches long? You know what it does? It puts 5 different plugs on your walkway. What do I do? I'm not going to put everything. It sucks. It totally sucks. Anyway, but I would like to now do my impression of everybody, every old person at the Lowe's. And they were young and old. It wasn't all. Mm-hmm. At the Lowe's, just going. Just crawling along, looking at lights. They're lights.
Yep.
You know, they're lights. Know what you want. You want colored lights. You want small lights. Fine. Just go and do it. Just go. It's the same way that they look at beef in a grocery store, you know, when they're just going, gonna look. Because looking at it is fun.
Yeah.
And that's all we're about in these United States now, stupidity and fun. That's what we're about. That is all we're about. We're not about any substance at all. There are no greatest generation people. They're dying, okay? They're not there. What they are is the children of the greatest generation just going, day after Thanksgiving, and I'm with them. I'm right there with them. I'm just as stupid,
sure you're
and
there,
mindless as they are.
You're
and
there,
maybe. And I just and I came on. Carl's like, "What is wrong?" I said, "I hate it. I hate the whole thing. I hate the. I want my house to be decorated. I want it to look nice for the neighborhood. That's why I want to be a nice one of those nice neighbors. But I hate the experience, every bit of it. My old man hated it. Apple doesn't fall far from the tree. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. He hated decorating that. Now I know why. Now I know why. Sorry, I need to get that off my chest.
What sort of decor do you plan outside?
What do you mean?
I mean, just lights and bushes. You can do lights around your house. How are you going to do it?
I have a little baby tree that I got one of these light wheels.
Yes.
That wound out, and the tree has three prongs. It's a little baby palm tree because I live near the equator, don't you know? That's why the house is 600 degrees. And I got two of the trunks, and then, of course, it ran out. You know? Because when you unwind it, you got to go up to the top and come back down. Because the plug's on the wrong end. I hate it. I hate the whole goddamn thing. Sorry about that, God. Sorry, Jesus.
God.
Sorry, God. Sorry, Jesus.
Excuse me, Lord.
Sorry, God, I was decorating for your son's birthday and the extension cord got messed up.
Yeah, yeah. And by the way, you know, and then I got the guy across the street. It's like a fucking Geico commercial. Hey, nah, how much that cost you? Huh? Hundreds of thousands of dollars. Anyway, that's it. We got to take a break. We'll come back. Happy Crimble. Merry Christmas. We're officially in the Christmas series. We'll be right back. Hi, thank you for letting me get that.
Of course.
You love people.
Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. It's that time of year again. So, do you want a perfect gift idea? For a limited time, TMOS listeners can get $5 off a holiday shave set by heading to harrys.com/TMOS. I love Harry's.
Yes.
It's a practical gift he'll actually use. Harry's makes sharp blades that last, German engineered and avoid winning. They're backed by a 100% quality guarantee. So if he doesn't love his shave, you get a full refund. And the gift keeps on giving. Harry's blade refills are as low as $2 each, so he'll save money over time. You can even make it personal by engraving the razor handle, and 1% of each sale is donated to charitable organizations. This holiday season, new customers can get $5 off plus free shipping on any Harry's limited edition holiday shave set when you go to harrys.com/TMOS. When I went to Harry's, I never went back. I have been a customer of Harry's for years. The sets come with a weighted handle, three razor cartridges, foaming shave gel, travel cover, all packaged in a handsome holiday gift box. I'll show you that gift box next time I talk about Harry's. Don't give an ugly tie this year. Delight the guys in your life with Harry's. It's the best. To claim your $5 off plus free shipping, go to harrys.com/TMOS. I am more than aware of my issues. I believe that is one thing that I can say about myself. I am aware of the fact that I am not normal, that I am slightly broken, and I realize that that sounds to people who may be tuning in for a holiday show right after the holiday, that when I bitch about people, I wish I was different. I wish I didn't feel that way.
Well, they say that knowing your problem is the first step to curing yourself, but I don't think that it's something that needs to be cured, and I also don't think... I don't think you are different as you think you are. I think there's a lot of people that
Thank
are like
you, Oscar.
You.
When do you like people?
Oh. When my wife, for example, this is a Christmas one.
Okay.
When my wife turns on the Christmas music too early, I find that charming.
Okay.
I don't find that dumb. I find that kind of cute because it's obnoxiously early.
Yep.
And that gives me, but that's my wife.
That's your wife. You married her. Yeah. You had to like her somehow, right?
I like you guys when you're busting chops.
Oh,
I enjoy that. But I work with you all the time.
We've
lasted over a decade, so that probably doesn't count.
Groups of people. When do you like groups of people?
En masse.
I don't. I don't like a group of people. I don't like, look, it's taken me, I've been 61 years on this planet. It's taken me this amount of time to know that socializing with large groups of people is just, I should have known this. When I was in the midst of my alcoholism, Oscar, when I was deep in the throes of alcohol abuse, I found it joyous to be around. Mm-hmm. But then when I look back on that, and you can look at if you really want to see the late 30s into the late 40s part of my life, or mid 40s, I should say.
And this is your age and not the decades, right?
This is my age.
Yeah. Okay, when you were in your 30s.
The roaring 30s.
Not like as America was preparing for World War II.
Not that. Anyway, thank you for that. I will tell you that you look at me during that period of time, all right, and the people I hung out with on a regular basis.
Good folks.
It was alcohol fueled, though.
Of course.
It was alcohol fueled. It was. Anytime I'm out with a large group of people, there'd be booze around. That would be, and I'm not alone in that.
No.
But I realized that you take really that out of the equation. And in order for me, look, do you think I'm alone in this? In order for me really to enjoy myself out with a large group of people, I don't think I'm alone. I would tune up a little bit. Put me in that situation without alcohol. I'm not all that happy.
At the live shows, you're happy.
Oh. The live shows, the best, and I know you teed it up for me because you've heard me say this before. I apologize. I should come to rehearsal more often. Thank you, Oscar. Look at Oscar right now. Thank you. Oscar, why don't we rehearse, do it like we did at rehearsal?
Aren't we all on, are me, we on page me the six?
Mike, we're on page six. Okay, ask me the question again.
Yeah. When do you love people?
I love people when I walk onto a stage and they're applauding for me. I said this to the guy. The reason we did
Mike
it like
said,
that,
I quote, I love to, people when I'm being adored.
Yeah, he likes
I
the
like
adoration.
People when I'm being adored. I even messed up that line. I like people when they're, you know, showing me adoration. When I'm walking out onto a stage, I love those people. By the way, and Carla told me that when I would be hesitant to go to, what's that hotel in Vegas that we all hang out at? What's
Downtown Grand.
Carla said, I said, I don't want to do that. I've done the show. I don't want to. Carla said, you'll love it. Yeah. So she said that to me, and I went to the Downtown Grand, and I ended up having a spectacular time. So that group of people I love.
So what if, Mike, if this...
I don't know. That's because of ego, right? Mm-hmm. Primarily, isn't it?
What if when you went to Lowe's, you got out of your car, you put on your mask, you go in, you step on the mat, the door opens, and the store goes quiet, and everyone in the Christmas section turns to you and applauds. Then is it a good trip to the hardware store?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes.
Be fantastic.
If you're recognized on that trip to Lowe's, which happens all the time in the DMV
for
all of us, if you're recognized, if when it happens to me, it
all right,
makes my
it doesn't effing have week. To be it doesn't have to be show recognition. I'll give you an example.
Yes. All right.
When I drive over to Cocoonville National and I'm driving along and I'll say, hey, Pete, hey, Sam, hey, Bill, how you doing? And I say, hey, Michael. I like that kind, too. I like to be known. I like to. Doesn't
well,
everybody
doesn't?
Like to be known? Don't you cheers, right? You want to go where everybody knows your name.
The difference is, Mike, you've been known the majority of your adult life.
Yeah.
Most people haven't. So I get where you're coming from. You're used to it.
But I don't want to be in
a like
social situation.
You don't like to wait.
No,
I don't like to.
You don't like to have to pay to access anything. It should just be given to you. You should just be able to access it.
Now you're going too far. Like you always do. Like you always do. You are going too far.
One of my favorite show patterns, though, is when Oscar starts listing things and you agree with diminishing enthusiasm as the list continues. You say, you don't like to wait. Right. You want things for free. Well,
that's why I enjoy social media, though, too. Where I can do that Helena Bonham Carter scene from Alice in Wonderland, you know, where somebody will somebody got on and said, I found a murder mystery funnier than the show. And I went, off with his head.
Yes, gone.
And he was gone, never to be spoken of again. That's why I like that. But no, it just, I don't know. I think probably you're right. And I think that might be abnormal, too.
That's what's wrong with any concert going experience I've ever had since I've left music radio.
Well, that's another thing. Mike hates concerts.
Because
I hate concerts.
Mm-hmm.
We were just because
I'm not performing.
This is going to sound douchey, but even when you're the van driver that gets there at 4 o'clock for an 11 p.m. show because you have to beat DC 101, you get a little pass that gets you into this little viewing gallery at the 9:30 Club when you could go to concerts.
Mm-hmm.
So when I would go to concerts after
special
the fact,
treatment.
I was like, ugh. Man, now I gotta get on my tippy toes and look over so I can see the band when you're on the balcony. There's no problem there. I'd rather drive the van and get here at 4 o'clock
for
a radio station promo. Pays me $10 an hour.
But they separated you from the matting crowd.
That's the only sliver I could ever connect with you on. Is that you've had that laminate pass your entire life, which I'm happy for.
Your entire life, remember that.
That is not true.
With a silver spoon in his mouth as a baby.
You can go.
Did you or did you not meet Hillary Duff?
You can go on that island with Lurch of the Sports Junkies and think that my life has been this dream scenario, and it has not. That is just the way. Everybody likes it. By the way, here are some slug lines for advertising.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Where everyone's a VIP. You're not a customer. You're like family. It's bull. It's not true. And by the way, where is that at its zenith where you're not treated like anything special? at the giant box store.
Of course.
At the giant box store where you're herded in. Hey, idiots, we're going to put the shiny lights up at the front of the store just over to the right. So coagulate in there with our narrow aisles so you can buy a plastic adapter for an extension cord, you stupid hump.
They know
and
you.
And then get
they
back
know
and
you.
Spend $16 for something that costs 5 cents to make and get out of there. And I'm telling you, and I'm not going to take it. I'm as mad as hell, and I'm not going to take it anymore. No, it sucks. It sucks. But I do expect that the Christmas spirit will be coming soon because I do have a 7-year-old and I can project all of it on him. And by
is
the
it
way,
starting
the
with
reason,
him?
Well, it is all him. It's all him.
I
That's
mean,
what
has
it's
he?
About.
But has he started to feel the excitement? Is what I'm saying.
He has a little setup on one of the tables in my home. That is a block set up with the multiple numbers on it.
Yeah. Oh, I love it.
And he turned it to 20 today, 20 days until Christmas. I have not had the heart to tell him. It's technically not 20 days till
Christmas.
Well,
it's 26, I think.
It's he's jumping the gun, but I didn't want, he was just about to
Does
get on
Does he think
the school
he's
going to
fool you? Like
no, he's not that sophisticated. He's not like your John Dillinger kids.
Trying to,
they're always trying to pull a fast one on
time
daddy,
shift you know? The holiday.
Exactly. No, Dad, it's on the 19th this year.
He's as innocent as the day is long.
Right? How dare you?
He's wonderful. But then again, I'll get into it for him. But that's not being anything but narcissistic because he is me.
Of
and he adores you, too.
Yes.
We love each other very much. Absolutely.
You're very fond of him.
Yeah. And by the way, Carla, I'm going to try to do better. Less yelling, less getting angry, and I will not refer to either of the dogs as that effort. I won't do that for the whole holiday season. We'll take a break, and we'll come back and find out how the Bolivian Thanksgiving was. Because he's still in town. Papa Santa.
Oh, yes. He's still in town. Big grudge.
We'll be right back, everybody. Welcome back to the Mike O'Meara Show, brought to you by Legacy Box. Legacy Box that we've all used is a safe, affordable way to digitally preserve all of your home movies and photos that are currently trapped on dated formats like VHS or film. To say that we all love Legacy Box would be an understatement. I've used Legacy Box after transferring things onto VHS that were on film before, and now I'm going to do it again. And they know exactly how to do it,
right.
So I can preserve the picture of my mom and dad's honeymoon when they were smoking. To say we all love it would be an understatement. We love it. It's fantastic. Mm-hmm. Imagine reclaiming all the priceless footage that you haven't been able to see in years. The service couldn't be simpler. Use their kit to safely send the moments you want preserved. Their team will create a digital archive by hand. They know what they're doing, and they do it carefully, and they take care of your precious memories. You'll receive your new copies stored on the cloud, a thumb drive or DVD, along with the original media you sent them. Once you have those digital versions, you can relax knowing they'll be secure for generations. Legacy Box is something you can order in minutes and enjoy forever. I did for my mom's 80th birthday a couple of decades ago, I did a wonderful video tribute to her, and the family loved it, and I'm glad that that's going to be around for my son to watch as well. This is the best deal of the year. Go to legacybox.com/TMOS to take advantage of this limited-time offer and get 60% off. This exclusive offer won't last long, so order a kit now and send it in whenever you're ready. It's a sale to remember. Go to legacybox.com/TMOS and save 60% while supplies last, and we thank you. Oscar, I know that Papa Santana came in from South America. I love that opening sentence. Came in from South America for the holiday. He is still here. He has landed, and
yes.
You had a good time, a very nice Thanksgiving.
Oh, he's Mike, I didn't realize my dad's almost 81, and he turns 81 in May. And he just, God willing, I'm as... I guess with it, and is the word spry? And,
spry is a good word. Yeah,
Like he doesn't. He walk. He actually. I feel like the work he's done in this past 8 months has really like reinvigorated him. And they tell you that
that's usually what happens.
Work
right?
keeps
that's
you alive, happens. Right?
Mm-hmm. But doesn't he keep spry with all those jaunts to the airport to get away from your family? That's what kept him alert all these years.
So. My father comes in town, and this is of all the Thanksgivings, you wonder, wow, your dad's coming from Latin America. He's got multiple COVID tests. We're doing the best we can with that situation. He's an epidemiologist. So if you think someone's going to do it right, it would be him, which he did. My sister from Los Angeles and her family stayed in Los Angeles. My brother in Boston stayed in Boston with his family.
They're all medical, by the way.
Yes, yes, they're all doctors, and they're all there. And it was my wife, Santos, my mom, and my dad. And my father, and most people I think that they're lucky enough to still have their parents around. There are true tells when someone's bored, whether it's your mom, dad, your sibling, when they just start looking away.
Disengage.
So I think my father's coming from a place where this is, and this is probably true, where at every turn he was being, you know, listened to and adored, like Mike loves, where it's, hey, what's the latest report on COVID, especially when you're dealing with a nation state, because he was helping out the Ministry of Health. And so he comes back with all those digits and numbers. And while I love my dad and I will always show him respect, if it was the States for some reason, because I'm ethnocentric and I'm Americano.
Getting a picture of what we're talking about. Here.
Give me some numbers about the States. I love Bolivia, but I've left and we're living here.
So he was telling his Bolivian story and you were looking out the window at a squirrel?
Yes.
Is that what was happening?
And I could tell he was getting annoyed because I didn't realize I was doing that, because at the end of the day, I'm still his youngest son, so he knows what's going on, right?
Right.
Rob, it's just like when we have the news and the audio.
Exactly. Yeah. Except
and
there's
he turns
no...
into a listener that doesn't.
But
if
I love something and I'm into it, then I'm into it, right?
Right. Yeah. But so, the sad but if thing I'm is not, here, he has no squirrel to watch, at least in Olney.
I'm like, oh, man, I got to check these emails. Right. but we have. So I'm sitting. This is the first time, by the way, in the 42 years I have been on this earth that I've ever got to sit at the other head of the table. So it was a big deal.
Oh, that's nice.
Usually by default, it's reserved for one of your brothers?
Yeah, one of the eldest male in the tribe.
Jose.
Right? Out of my dad. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. All right.
By default, it fell to me. So I was like, oh, this is pretty nice. A lot of elbow room, not like this.
Mm-hmm.
Squeezed in next to my wife. And that might have gone to my head because my dad's talking about Bolivia. And I would say I gave him a good 45 minutes. And I was like, hey, Pops, I love you. I was like, but, what are your thoughts on the States? What's going on here? Let's talk about these vaccines.
All right. You know what? And I will give you credit. That was, although you're cutting him off at the knees.
Yes.
You did it politely.
Yes.
So that's good.
My dad.
When you're legitimate, at least you're still on the same subject matter.
Right. Yes.
You want him to engage with what's happening here at
Los
home.
Estados Unidos.
Yes.
Right. And then he looks at me, pauses, looks around, and continues his conversation. I didn't say anything.
Oh, the big diss.
Yeah. And then he says, Oscar, I was given a plaque when I left Bolivia by the Secretary of Health. Go fetch it from my office. So then he pulled his thing out and threw it on the table and basically saying, hey, I'm still the boss.
Right.
So then I sheepishly got up in my dress shoes and suit, because that's what we wear to Thanksgiving, and walked and got his little plaque. And at the end of the table, imagine me, grown man, holding the plaque up for my wife and my mom and my dad so he could read it off to the family.
You screwed up bad, little
exactly.
brother. This is what happened right now.
And when you
dad,
return with the
that.
Plaque.
I know. Hey, Dad, I know you saved a few hundred thousand lives, but Dad, hey, I want to talk about the United States now, okay? Come on now, all right?
When I'm done reading the plaque, you may sit down, but not at the head of the table.
Can you translate what the plaque said?
Yeah, the plaque is something beautiful that you would get for going above and beyond, like a medal, like a citizen medal that you would get from the president of Bolivia. And the president signs it.
I know.
Even his tone now is dismissive.
I know.
Yeah, the plaque was like, he saved a bunch of lives, and there it is
Have you ever heard of the Congressional Medal?
What about D.C.? What about Olney? Little Oscar over here. Evan Alaska, the one that went to that party. Remember that? Come on now.
Oh, my God. Well, we got more to come on that, I swear to God.
Hey, Dad.
Oscar, you have no idea who you're speaking to. You have no... Oh, I believe he's going to have to make a comeback on this show.
I was a stain on his shirt, let me tell you.
Yeah. You know, am I the only one that when you mention you're in a coat
name
and tie...
Name of the show today, Stain on the Shirt.
That's exactly it. When there I picture him in the coat and tie, I picture him a coat and tie, but short pants.
because he's being ordered around by his old man. Go get the plaque.
See the plaque?
Map.
See the plaque?
Map.
There's the plaque.
Map.
There's the plaque.
I deserved it. I get it.
Oh,
man.
Boy.
Why don't you have your pie in the garage?
Anyway, we got to take a break. We'll come back with news you may not need. This isn't a show. It's a therapy session.
Yeah.
Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. I'm done with Buseyisms. It's clear that 2020 has been a year unlike any other, which is why you need a sports book with offers unlike any other.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Get in on the fun with MyBookie, where the action never stops, whether you're a first-timer or have been playing for years. You're going to love MyBookie. If you can imagine it, you can bet on it, like betting that the New York Giants would take first place in the NFC East. Sorry, Washington football team.
They were first for a little while. A couple days.
Alex Smith.
You just listen to something that Mike O'Mara could never do on terrestrial radio, right? What I just did then. Be honest about my loyalty to my hometown team, even though they're 3.5 hours south of where I grew up. Don't miss MyBookie's huge casino platform. I have played this. I think it's fantastic. I love their slot machines. It's a lot of great fun. You get access to all the classic table, slot, and card games. And the best part is, at MyBookie, the doors never close. So when you're sitting there and your wife's playing Mega Touch, you slide over to MyBookie and slot. Make the smart play and sign up today at MyBookie. Use promo code TMOS at sign up to grab yourself a free $20 bet with your deposit. The terms are simple. You make your deposit, use the code, and you get hooked up with a free bet to use on anything on the sports book. If you've been on the fence about trying your hand at betting, this is a great way to get in on it. And since it's on the house, you can't beat it. It's officially winning season at MyBookie. Join in on the fun and win some cash while you're at it at MyBookie, everybody.
News.
Boo. Yeah, more Thanksgiving from Robb and Oscar and me. And we had a full weekend.
We did.
And that's why we all have to come in here on the Monday after and purge ourselves of our demons.
Demons.
I hope I pronounced this correctly. The quinquagenarian boxing match. Did I say that correctly?
I believe so.
54-year-old Mike Tyson and 51-year-old Roy Jones Sr., Jr., but he's senior, went down on Saturday. Both of them were impressive, but Iron Mike was outstanding. Did you buy it? Did you buy the fight?
I spent the $50.
Good for you.
I couldn't do it.
I couldn't bring myself
to do it. Officially, the fight ended in a draw. It was an exhibition anyway. Mm-hmm. But Tyson looked like the clear-cut winner. It was an exhibition. There were 8 2-minute rounds. No knockouts were allowed. And there weren't any official judges. Instead, there were celebrity judges who declared it a tie. Did they introduce the celebrity judges at all?
Sugar Ray Leonard
was there. That's good enough for me.
Yeah.
Tyson landed 67 of his 193 punches for a 34.7% accuracy rate compared to Jones. 37 landed shots. That's almost double from 236 attempted. Even George Foreman thought Tyson looked good. He tweeted, quote, "Tyson does not fight like he's 50. He's in shape too much for Roy." He also said it was the best exhibition he's ever seen. The fight aired on pay-per-view, $50. Oscar paid the money. And even if you didn't enjoy the fight, you had to get a kick out of the color commentary provided by Snoop Dogg.
Oh, fantastic.
Who's just shy of 50 himself. At one point, he described the fight as, quote, "like two of my uncles fighting at the barbecue." That's funny. By the way, Snoop would get a kick out of this. Tyson admitted to smoking a joint right before the fight. Then he threw 193 punches in 16 minutes. Tyson said, quote,
"Listen, I can't stop smoking. I smoke during fights. I have to smoke. Sorry, I'm a smoker. I smoked every day. I never stopped smoking. That's just who I am."
Both Tyson and Jones took home a guaranteed $1 million. Tyson could end up making around $10 million for his win, while Jones could net $3 million. Well, they said it was a draw, so why would they say that? I don't know. Afterward, Tyson said he's absolutely interested in fighting again, but Jones didn't know. He said he'd have to talk it over with his family. That tells you all you need to know about those two guys.
You know,
right?
The pre-fight joint is a tradition started by Howard Cosell.
This is Howard Cosell speaking of weed. Remember the infomercials for Flobee?
Yes, of course.
That was the self haircutting system that looked like a cross between a vacuum and a hair cutter.
It actually looks like a modern day Dyson.
Well, this is a fact that blew me out of the water. No one knew who actually tried it, but now you do. George Clooney said he used the Flobee, and he just he gave it a whirl back in the day. He is still using it regularly.
Clooney.
Yes. In an interview with CBS Sunday Morning yesterday, George was asked if he's trimming his own hair during quarantine. He said, quote, "I've been cutting my own hair for 25 years. My hair is really like straw, so it's easy to cut. You can't make too many mistakes. Years ago, I bought a thing called a Flobee. Mm. I still have it. My haircuts take literally 2 minutes. He was asked if the cut he was rocking for the interview was done by a Flobee, and he said yes.
Wow.
George Clooney. How about that?
That's
I
crazy.
Love that.
I tell you what,
you think
CBS,
it's true or do you think it's BS?
He messes with people a lot. I bet he has done it.
He's
but
got
I've,
a hairstylist on
yeah,
staff.
I've got, he's got to.
There you go, Flobee. According to a new study out of the University of Birmingham in England, drinking hot chocolate can make you smarter. The researchers say it's because some molecules in cocoa called flavanols, they make your brain work faster and more efficiently. Isn't that kind of like a caffeine rush?
Sure.
A little bit,
yeah.
Maybe? There's only one downside. If your brain is already functioning really well, the flavanols won't help you out. And since you're a genius, that means you. But for the rest of us, bring on the hot chocolate.
It's yeah.
And it doesn't say what kind. Probably not the instant, you know,
it's
the
always
chemical
helped. It's always
chocolate.
Helped Charlie, hasn't it?
Oh, it's, you know, it's his standard beverage.
Yeah, and his
breakfast,
favorite.
Breakfast, lunch, and dinner.
Lots of marshmallows. I mean,
well, no, he uses, Charlie, don't, Charlie.
Oh, is he
Charlie,
there?
Come here. He's coming in right now.
I didn't know that.
Hello? What?
Hey, Charlie.
What do you
hi,
want?
Charlie.
Yeah, you're there, and I'm here. What?
Do you like what's hot chocolate?
I like that. I like Herb Welch.
He's funny.
Yeah. I drink chocolate, hot chocolate,
and
chocolate
does,
milk.
Does it make you smarter?
Yes, sir.
Bye.
Bye, Charlie.
Bye, boys.
Bye,
Charlie.
Oh, long there he goes. Long that's time. Charlie, everyone. Charlie, post-weekend Charlie. According to a new survey, people are slightly more likely to say the holiday season will actually be less stressful. We talked about that. Than in a normal year. 52% say the holidays are normally stressful. I totally agree. The discussion I was having earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Well, this year it's down to 48% that say it's stressful. So it's not a massive difference, but it's a real one. And it makes sense. This year could see less traveling, fewer parties, fewer family gatherings, fewer arguments over whose family to spend time with, and emptier calendars. Those are a lot of huge sources of stress. All gone. Stress.
Stress.
Stress. Yes. Watch out for that stress, everybody. I feel that way. I mean, I had a quieter, smaller Thanksgiving. I usually have a small one anyway, but did you like that it was, didn't you like that it was just your dad and your mom?
I looked at Shannon on the way back to our house in D.C. and I said, look, don't tell anybody, but I loved that we didn't have to do anything crazy this year.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
She said,
you guys saw a lot of moving parts.
She said, why would you say that? I said, I love my family, but I'll see them next year. We're good this year.
Yeah.
Well, let's go to the guy that has the biggest gathering usually. What did you think about your downsized Thanksgiving?
We went
year?
From 65 people to 6 people. And I loved it because I controlled all the working parts of dinner. I didn't have to rely on people bringing 2 turkeys from here and a ham from there. And is the stuffing going to be here on time? And oh, yeah, I need the oven right now. It was so chill and easy to do. I stopped and I said, why is it so easy this year? I said, oh, yeah, because it's smaller.
Yeah,
it's
I think
smaller.
That's it. I really agree. I think most people
I love
do.
My
I think
family.
That number's probably
miss
low.
The family. Don't miss the mechanics of what goes into it.
Amen. Yeah. I couldn't agree more. And I think we might learn something from that, but I'm not sure. Here's my favorite story of the week so far. British Airways is investigating right now after they found out that one of their flight attendants was running a side hustle offering sexual services to passengers. But it's a kinky one.
Oh.
For $33, she'd sell her underwear. For $66, she'd give it to you in person at a hotel. And if the, quote, money is right, you could get more sexual services. You could also pay for, quote, adult entertainment on board the flights. They don't specify what it was. Could I have another blanket, please? She was advertising. She was advertising the services on OnlyFans. Isn't that kind of like the X-rated service where you can pay for?
There are reputable models on there.
Thank you, expert. But
you might want to go there until your air conditioning is fixed, Mike. And maybe find a
her
fan of your own.
Accounts were deleted yesterday after BA found out about her. Well, not specifically her. British Airways is trying to figure out which of their flight attendants this is. They don't know who it is specifically yet. Spokesperson says, quote, "It's a shocking dereliction of duty and not the image British Airways wants for its cabin crew." Mm. So we're going to have to find out.
My sister-in-law is with United, so we're okay. And by the way, she did state, Mike, exact change is, as always, appreciated.
I'll meet you in the lobby. And now a little something-something, a Florida man. Yeah, it couldn't be a three-day weekend without a Florida man. Posted a video showing off his family's most unusual pre-Thanksgiving tradition. By the way, this guy lives just up the road a piece. What they do is they thaw out their turkey in the backyard swimming pool.
Gross. Gross.
And he's Irish. Mark O'Donnell posted a Facebook Live video showing his family dumping the 16-pound bird into the swimming pool behind their Clearwater home to thaw it out for cooking. O'Donnell said the turkey's packaging was closely examined for leaks before the thawing process to make sure none of the chlorinated water seeped into the meat. He said the turkey will be removed after spending a day thawing in the pool. O'Donnell said his family has been thawing the Thanksgiving turkey in the pool for 18 years. And every one of those years, Aunt Becky says the turkey tastes like pee.
There you go. Oh, Becky.
It's so disgusting.
That's nasty. That's so
throw it in the pool. Look what I'm doing. There you go. We closely examine it for leak. That turkey look good, Ethel? Yes, sir. Throw it in the pool. Yum, yum.
And also, anyway, I'd be as concerned about turkey juice in the pool as gross. I would water in the turkey.
Ah, we got people that bleed in the pool all the time. Brian, don't worry about it.
That's called people brine.
That's Uncle Ray. Oh. You know, Uncle Ray, that toe of his. We'll take a break. We'll go back with more thrills on the Mike O'Mara Show. Blood jokes. Welcome back to the Mike O'Mara Show. With Thanksgiving in the rearview mirror, it's full steam ahead to Christmas.
Yay!
Will you be ready? Will you be ready? Are your stockings well hung? Have you puddinged your plums? Have you hung two sprigs of mistletoe 6 feet apart for COVID kissing? Will you remember to leave out cookies and vaccine for old St. Nick? There's so much to forget. But one thing is easy to remember because you can do it right now.
Oscar, I'm talking now.
Now.
Remember to give the gift of the TMOS bonus show and share laughter all year long. Yes, it's the bonus show. A gift that's great for everyone on your list, even yourself. It's the best and funniest way to support TMOS. Just go to MikeOMaraShow.com, click the bonus banner, and sis boom ba. Every bonus show ever at your fingertips. Ho, ho, ho.
No offense.
The bonus show. Now and forever. Your Christmas passport to the Yuletide Asport. Bonus show. Buy it at MikeOMaraShow.com. Buy it. They told me. Pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Don't be dumb.
Little drummer boy loves the bonus
show. It's the audio ball. Play that sound thing. Thank you.
Mike,
what?
It's been a while since I've played you a great parody record. Do you know what today is?
What is it?
Today, Cyber Monday. So get ready to shop.
Cyber Monday, so good for me.
Oh, lazy second lyric gets you the bomb. Gets the bomb. A lazy second lyric.
You're right.
Gets the explosion right away. You don't lead if you're doing that laziest song. You don't go so good for me. Cyber Monday, so good for me. You know what you get when you do that? You get the explosion. You get blowed up real good. Thank you.
But it doesn't mean you shouldn't visit Walmart and Target through the Mike O'Mara Show portal. Today is a great day to do it.
But of course.
He was 85, and he really sort of got cheated out of all the glory he could have gotten, but his name was David Prowse, and he was the guy who played Darth Vader in the costume. He passed away over the weekend. He did not do the voice of Darth Vader, and even when they took off Darth Vader's helmet,
just out of curiosity, I don't want to speak ill of the dead.
Yeah.
It's not what I choose to do. Are you going to be spotlighting like people up at a Disney World in Orlando and one of the guys that's inside the Mickey suit dies too?
No, he was. You have to know that he was very well loved, and he was a big part of it because he was the imposing
figure.
Why was
he very well loved? He was a guy in a suit, didn't even use his voice. They used James Earl Jones's voice.
Yes,
right?
As a matter of fact, Mike, he did use his voice in early takes, and it was dubbed over. Here's how he sounded as Darth Vader.
I'm tearing this ship apart piece by piece until you find those tapes. Find the passengers of this vessel. I want them alive.
I'm a member of the Imperial Senate on a diplomatic
mission. You are part of the Rebel Alliance and a traitor.
Oh, okay, now I know why they used James Earl Jones.
Of course, of course. But he was a very tall...
Want to hear my impression of one of the scenes he was in?
Please.
All right, here we go. I'm going to try. Here we go. I'm sorry. No, I know
that's
he
right.
was revered by the...
But he was an adult puppeteer, essentially. Right?
Essentially, yeah. And he was offered also the role of Chewbacca.
I know your people love you for this. So that's,
he was offered the role of Chewbacca or Darth Vader, and he chose Darth Vader because he says villains are more fun. I thought that was a neat answer.
And Chewbacca, the guy in the Chewbacca suit died too, right?
I believe so, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That was, everybody
I could do Chewbacca too.
Harrison
I could do the sword
Ford and Mark Hamill.
They're still alive.
Yeah.
Because Carrie Fisher's gone. Mm-hmm.
They're calling it, Mike, the Star Wars curse.
I can do the sword and Chewbacca in the same
thing.
Right?
Do Chewbacca with a lightsaber.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Mike, this is a great Thanksgiving tape. Have you ever seen a guy get the tires stolen and they usually prop up the car with like a cinder block or bricks, right?
Oh, I've seen that.
Yeah.
In the Bronx.
So this guy,
not just the Bronx. It's not, excuse me, I'm not Donald Trump.
No.
Only in the Bronx. That's the only place crime happens. No. It can happen anywhere. You steal a tire or you borrow a tire or you work on a car and you prop it up usually with little blocks.
Yeah. So this guy,
bricks or blocks.
This guy comes out, his back left tire is stolen and his car is resting on a frozen turkey.
I've never seen anything like this before. I've heard of people, you know, putting bricks, but I've never heard of a turkey underneath. I hope you enjoy that tire because you could have gave that turkey to somebody who really needed it.
Amen.
Yes.
And by the way, get that out of the under the car, throw it right in the pool.
Let it thaw. Let it thaw. Watch out for the toe.
Right. The bloody toe. Uncle Ray's bleeding toe.
The COVID regulations and the limited attendance to NFL games is really affecting a segment of the population that you might not think of. People that surround Lambeau Field are missing their parking money.
They estimate this community will lose $150 million without fans in the stands here at Lambeau this season. The homes around the stadium have long used their property as parking lots for ticket holders, and the money generated over those 10 games was often used to pay their property taxes. So Lambeau's neighbors financially and emotionally impacted this season.
Oh, sure, come in then. $20, you can park in the yard.
All right. Well, you know, we've all, I don't want to be, I feel like this is the show where I'm showing no compassion.
No.
But, you know, we all have our bumps in the road.
I agree.
You get lucky enough because you're, you know, your little duplex gets, you know, is on a road that leads down to Lambeau. I mean, that's everybody. That's everybody. Yeah. It's not just Lambeau Field.
Look what's happening
that's
in Atlanta, Maryland.
It's also hard on the people, Pimlico, Mike.
Atlanta, Maryland. That's right. Yeah. Park in my yard for $40. Thank you. Thanks for your generosity. Really sorry those people are getting screwed.
Yeah. I let people park in my yard in Leesburg, but the business is just gone. I don't know why.
No.
They're not coming.
I used to have people. I didn't charge anybody when they had the train festival in Manassas.
You could park in Mike's yard and then go get kettle corn.
Choo choo.
Go get kettle corn from the guy that wore the big, you know, Curious George hat.
That's right.
The man in the yellow suit.
That's true.
What a great place to live.
Yeah. You could go and see that train festival and stand on that big slab of concrete. It was great.
Go see a guy that's got a plywood little box with a train on it and he's wearing a conductor's hat. Choo choo. Jeez.
I bet COVID ruined that this year.
Probably.
And Mike, this is a bad time. Holidays are a bad time for senior citizens.
Almost half of Americans over 56 years old say they may not see their families at any point during the holiday season, but only because they can't figure out Zoom.
Grandma, click on the microphone and then unmute. That's your magic audio vault. Have a great Monday, everybody.
All right, more Thanksgiving fun tomorrow. And, you know, it's the Christmas season, so if you're out and about, share that Christmas spirit with somebody. Hold a door. Help somebody with their groceries.
Help someone reach for those elusive Christmas lights. Mm. Think about someone other than yourself.
But like don't touch a hand. In years past, you would say touch a hand.
Touch a hand, make a friend.
But don't do it in COVID, no.
Don't do it, no. How about just letting a smile be... Well, that doesn't mean anything anyway because you have a mask on. Oh, F it. Everybody for themselves. We'll be back tomorrow with another show. For Oscar Santana and Robb Spiewak, Mike O'Mara saying so long, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Ciao, ciao.
Before you go, please make a mental note. Today's show was made possible by the TMOS bonus packages. You can secure yours right now by going to MikeO'MaraShow.com and clicking on the red bonus banner. Buy it or give it. Either way, you're helping out TMOS, and that's a good thing. Thank you, and go in peace.
Mike O'Mara, Radio Entertainment.
Do you know who I am? I'm Mo Green.
Well, bye.